Hello, Patrick Walchuk here, reporting on this month's stats from our COVID-free studios, otherwise known as my living room. So what we're going to do this month is get right into the stats. At the end of this movie, I'll have a little bit of information for you about how the COVID virus is affecting the Ottawa real estate market. And if you enjoy getting these statistics, subscribe to our channel and we'll send them to you every 30 days as we update things. So other than that, you know the drill. Step 6 feet away from your computer screen or from your cell phone. At the end of this movie, put your computer or your cell phone into a sink of bleach and it'll kill the virus. Okay, so we'll get right into the stats, and they are to the end of March 2020, but what we're looking at is just what happened in the month of March, comparing it to March of last year. So for Ottawa overall, there were 1,143 homes sold in March, and that's an increase of about 2.5%. I'm going to round some of these numbers. So if what you're looking at on our blog is a little bit different, it's just me rounding some fractions, okay? Now, freehold sales, anything other than a condominium, those have been up almost 6% this year. And condominiums, we had 340 of those sell, which is a decline of about 4% over, again, March of last year. The average price for both freehold and condominiums for March is almost $540,000, and that's a huge increase of 20%. Now, I say huge, but it's basically the same as it was at the end of February. And for just freehold homes in Ottawa, the average price now is $611,000. And that's an increase of 17%. For condominiums, the average price is about $372,000. And that's an increase of 30%. Massive, massive numbers. Now, in terms of how long it was taking a house to sell in March, they sold in 15 days this year compared to 28 days last year. And condominiums were selling in 22 days compared to 44. So basically, condo sales were happening in half the amount of time. Now, here's an interesting number. The inventory report, or inventory levels, which are the actual number of homes on the market. So at the end of this month, they were down 22%. There were 2,051 freehold homes for sale. Again, they were down 22%. And last year in March, I was telling you that they were down 22% at that time as well. So it's just a huge drop off in condominiums. Let's see here, the average inventory levels, or not the average, but the actual is 305 condos on the market for sale right now. And by the way, I'm recording this on April 2nd. That's a decline of 62% over last year. Condo inventory levels down 62%. And this time last year, I was reporting to you that they were down 34%. So it's just a desert out there if you're looking to buy a condominium. So that's the overall general market for Ottawa. Now we're going to break this down into our typical three major neighborhoods, Orleans, Barrhaven, and Kanata, and we'll start in the east with Orleans. So the total amount of sales in March was 195 homes sold, which was identical with March of last year. For freehold homes, again, anything that's not a condominium, there were 154 homes sold, which is an increase of 5%. Condominiums had 41 sales, which was a slight decline of about 13%. The numbers aren't large, but it is still a decline. The average price for a freehold home in Orleans in March was about $531,000, and that's an increase of 20%. And condos were going for $318,000, and that's an increase of almost 26%. In terms of how long it was taking for a home to sell in Orleans, they were selling on average in just 10 days, which is 50% of the time of what they were selling at last year. So moving on to Barrhaven, we had 144 sales, which is an increase of 21%. Breaking that down into freehold sales, there were 122 of them, which is an increase of 26%, and condominium sales, there were 22, which was exactly the same as the previous year. Now, in terms of prices in Barrhaven of these types of homes, freeholds, the average sold price was $552,000, and that's an increase of 21%. And for condominiums, the average price, the average price was $332,000, and that's an increase of 26%. In terms of how long it took to sell, they were selling on average in 10 days compared to 17 days last year. Now, looking at the final major area, which is Kanata, there were 160, that's 160 homes sold this year in March, and that's an increase of 5%. Freehold had 137 sales, that's an increase of 5% as well. And condominiums, there were 23 sell compared to 22 last year, so that's basically a wash. Now, in terms of pricing, the average sold price in Kanata is $580,000. $580,000 for a freehold, and that's an increase of 24%. Condominiums, the average sold was $343,000. That's an increase of 22%. And in terms of how long it took for a property to sell, they were selling in 10 days compared to 21 last year, so in about half the time. So this is pretty typical of what's gone on so far this year. And in terms of the major three neighborhoods, Kanata certainly has the most expensive homes, slightly followed by Barrhaven, and Orleans has the least expensive. So depending on how you look at it, Kanata's a great place to have a property to sell right now, or Orleans is the most affordable place if you're looking to get the biggest bang for your buck. Now, in terms of how the virus has been affecting the real estate market, I'll tell you what I've seen and how it's progressed. Now, basically, the Ontario government declared a state of emergency on March 17th. So when we look at sales, what has gone on from March 17th until the end of March, the number of listings in Ottawa was down, let's call it the COVID-19 period. They were down 6%, which isn't much. That really, really surprised me. And the number of homes sold in this COVID period was actually up 7%. Now, things have been progressing fairly rapidly, and we'll see what the stats in April brings us, but I am expecting some significant declines. Here's what I personally have experienced and seen and had conversations with my colleagues about. So it first started off with when somebody has a home listed for sale, there would be instructions for realtors when showing the property, don't touch anything. Okay. Then shortly after, I was seeing, don't touch anything, leave all the lights on, the doors will be open. Do not use any of the bathrooms. There will be a 30-minute showing time only. So typically, owners let you in for about an hour, but these are being cut to 30 minutes. And the agent may only be allowed to take one person into the house at a time. So if it's like a husband and wife, then maybe the wife comes in first with the realtor, then she waits outside for 15 minutes, and then the husband comes in with the realtor, and that's it. Then a few days later, I was seeing things like agents must have buyers sign a disclosure and provide their driver's license information in the event that they do have COVID-19, they leave the virus in the house, and if they knowingly have it and they saw the property, I suppose that this information would be reported and perhaps setting up future litigation against those buyers for possibly coming into the house and infecting the homeowners. So now we're getting into some really elaborate disclosure statements that must be signed. Now, I have to state that this is more the exception than the rule. And most places out there just want you to disclose that as a buyer agent, you have discussed this with your clients. And if you haven't, then you're an idiot, okay? And you shouldn't even be showing properties if that's the case. So at least have a verbal discussion with the parties involved. Then there was followed by, I'm seeing more of these, no showings. So you have a listing, no showings. You can only look at the house once the seller has accepted your offer. So your offer would have various conditions in there, one would assume. But one of the conditions is it's conditional upon the buyer being able to view the property. Otherwise, don't even step on the front doorstep. And if you have a property that has a tenant inside of it, they've all but shut down. The tenants will not allow any buyers into the property. The odd one will, but if there's anybody who's elderly, forget it. They're not letting anyone into their apartment or into the house. And finally, another thing that's been happening recently is that there's clauses and conditions built into offers dealing with the COVID crisis. So I've used a couple of these myself recently. So if, for example, the land registry office is closed, let's say the employees there can't work and the property is due to close on a specific date, but the land registry office isn't open that week, then the property can't close. So you build in a remedy for that, whatever it might be, that the property will close within 5 days after the land registry office having reopened. Or the same thing is true of the ability to obtain land title insurance. There's another clause that deals with the situation. What if the buyer or the seller who saw the property or allowed the property to be shown and everybody was COVID-free, but 2 months from now, when it comes time to close, one of those parties has contracted the virus? What do you do then? Well, there's a clause for that. And then certain things like keys. What if the lawyers aren't able to exchange keys? So there's a clause built in there that the listing realtor will leave the keys in a lockbox on the door with the security code provided to the buyer's agent upon closing, that kind of thing. So this is really something that is progressing daily. It's getting more complicated. It's getting more restrictive. And I'm quite likely expect to see that we will see fewer sales and fewer listings in April, but I'll tell you the end of March certainly is not indicative of that. Anyhow, that's it. You know, if you want to call me or email me, please do so. And don't forget, subscribe to our video if you enjoy these. Bye-bye.